$100 treats, and we're talking dollar gifts. I'm not using $100 treats. Just like a dollar. Three of them, bring them around. For bingo prizes, bring three of them. For bingo prizes, no, we're not turning them into a gambling hall. This is not for cash, this is for little prizes. You'll have a great time with that. So, the sister brings some bingo prizes there, and three wraps of gifts, and we'll be present there all together. The other is Saturday morning, it is common to de-decorate the church. And so, I really appreciate those of you who came and helped to put up the decorations. Now it's time to set down the decorations. I will say to you that we're down the bottom of the house. But you can use your help to set them down. So, 10 o'clock Saturday morning, we will be taking down the decorations. De-decorating. And so, if you're willing, I appreciate your help in that. And why don't we stand on the floor and let's go. You have any problems with this one? Thank you.
Thank you.
book of Colossians. You may be seated. The book of Colossians, chapter 1, is Paul's prayer for the Colossians. He says, for this reason, since the day we heard about you, we have not stopped praying for you. We continually ask God to fill you with the knowledge of His will, through all wisdom and understanding that the Spirit gives. What a wonderful prayer to pray for the coming year. May God's Word fill us, fill you with the knowledge of His will. Praise God. So that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and please Him in every way. Again, what a great way to pray. Lord, that I may please you in every way. Nothing to offend you. Bearing fruit in every good work, growing in the knowledge of God. What a fantastic passion to read in the new year. All these things apply in your life and in our church. Being strengthened with all power according to His glorious might, so that you might have great endurance and patience. Praise God. And giving joyful thanks to the Father, who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of His holy people in the kingdom of life. You've been qualified. Here's the peace of the Lord. All of these are true. For He has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son who loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. It's not by anything we have done, it's according to what God has done. It's according to what Jesus has done in our lives. We can be strengthened, we can be fruitful, we can endure, we can be filled with the knowledge of the will of God. All these things are incredible. It's all dependent on this basis. For He has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son He loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. Praise God and glory to the Lamb, who willingly laid down His life that we might be rescued. If you are in Christ, you were rescued. Some people don't like that word because they say, well, look at that. But it has that connotation. If you were overboard, you were in the open sea, you were drowning. And He came to the end, rescued you. Saved you at the very last moment. Going down for the last time. From darkness to the light, into the kingdom of His Son. We have the elements here this morning, and we want to celebrate that rescue. That rescue. I can assure you that if you were in the open sea and somebody came by at the last moment and rescued you from drowning, you would be thankful to them, and you would celebrate that today for the rest of your life. Yes. You were rescued. You were rescued from more than just drowning. You were given eternal life.
get out with your friends. I'm sure you have somebody to help you this morning. My heart is full of thanksgiving. Praise to God that He has rescued us from darkness and did so by holding us to suffering on the cross for us. For you, at the very last moment.
We bow before you and we thank you. We owe you our lives, our souls. Thank you for rescuing us, bringing us from death and life. Thank you for being willing to lay down your life as we might live. Thank you for redemption, for forgiveness of sins. Lord Jesus, could there be anyone here who has sin in their lives, I pray that you would move them to confess their sins to you, for you are faithful and just to cleanse us from sin, to forgive us from sin, and to cleanse us from all our righteousness. Jesus took bread and made him blessed and said, "This is my body that is broken for you. Remember me in the gospel of union." Dad, would you bless this bread, please? Thank you.
Jesus.
Scripture says that after heaven, Jesus took the cup. And when he blessed him, he said, "This is my blood of the new covenant." Remember me, Jesus. Mary, you just for several years, I think 4 years, in the Assembly of God has committed the first week of COVID of the year to a week of prayer and called all of the churches in the council to pray the first full week. You are to participate in that this year. And so in response to that, we are calling for a week of prayer. We will have the church open every day, Monday through Friday, from noon to 1, and there won't be anything organized per se. You are simply encouraged and prayed to come into the sanctuary. That is a focus, a prayer focus each day that's been put forth from the general council. For you to direct you in your prayers. You don't feel like you need to, spend an hour, but if you want to spend an hour, you're free to spend an hour. If you want to come for 10 minutes, 15 minutes, 5 minutes. If you can't come, I would encourage you to pray at home. But commit this week to prayer. Now that I say Monday to Friday, we get Saturday. Well, we already have prayer Saturday evening, so we'll come and pray Saturday evening instead of noon on Saturday. So, it starts today. It's the first day of this week of prayer. And if you can have that supply, you can have that. Consistency in prayer, consistency in prayer of God, is telling God's word. In every area of life, hold fast to your faith. Endure. So that is the prayer focus for today. If you look in your bulletin, there is a list in every day that has been written. Prayer focus. One of them is for evangelism for souls in the faith. One is for global evangelism in the bulletin. But today is consistency. It starts with prayer and continues through every area of our life. The Christian life is not about one time experience. It's about a relationship with Jesus Christ. And so I would like to put this into practice this morning. I'd like for us to spend a few moments. If you would like to pray where you are, I'd like to ask you all. If you'd like to pray for the stay there, pray for your feet. If you'd like to come to these altars, you find a place. Why don't we all pray that God helps us? You know, not even these things that you don't know about. All things are something. Let's pray that God gives us consistency. You know, that we can get better consistency in our life. I'm going to pray. Thank you. that you would strengthen us, that you would embolden us to be people of prayer. Just this one prayer, Lord, this daily prayer, consistent prayer, prayer that is pleasing to you. Pray that we would cast our eyes on you, fix our eyes on you, and be all good and finished with our faith. Thank you, Lord, that you who have started will be faithful to complete the work that you have started to do. Draw us to this.
just back in His presence. To the sweet spirit, to the sweet presence of God.
Just wanted to read verses 6 and 7 of Psalm 95. Come, let us worship Jesus. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for He is our God. And we are the people of His pasture and the flock under His care. Thank you that we are yours. You are our shepherd. And we bow before you and we glorify you, for you are our God and our Savior and our King. Thank you. As we begin the new year, it gives us the opportunity to discuss the different disciplines that should be present in our lives. If we're going to be all that God would have us to be, both individually and in the church, these disciplines should be in place. These consistencies should be in place. It is my intent, the Lord will, and you too, in the next few weeks, discuss such disciplines, such as Bible reading and prayer and sharing our faith, and a few others as the Lord. My prayer for you is that each of us will take each of these disciplines You know, discipline is not necessarily a bad thing. When we hear discipline, we think of a pattern. But it's not the pattern. This is the discipline or the consistency that we should develop so that the pattern, the discipline, doesn't. I'd rather discipline myself than be disciplined by God or by another. The truth is, if we're going to be all God calls and preach God, His calls us to be, we must be willing to practice the things of God. We must be about our Father's business. Today, I'd like to bring to your attention one of the foundational disciplines. The discipline that comes even before prayer and Bible reading. It's a call to worship. It's a call to worship God. If we're going to be a disciple of Jesus Christ, we must be disciplined in worshiping God. Psalm 95, 6 and 7. We let it that well. Some let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for He is our God, and we are the people of His pasture. The flock under His care. I know what time it is. Don't be concerned. Is it okay? Three elements to the call to worship that I would like to talk to you about. The call to worship is the call. To recognize the presence of God in your life. Too often we go through life and we do not recognize God's presence or His kingship in our life. Sometimes we leave God at church and then we go about our business. I say to you, take God. Recognize God's presence. He said, never will I leave you or forsake you. And that is true. The problem is sometimes we don't recognize that. To worship Him means to recognize Him and His presence in our lives. We know that He is an ever-present help in time of trouble, but you know that He's an ever-present help when things are good. The reality is that He is ever-present. Sometimes we just don't recognize it. Sometimes the circumstances of life overwhelm us and we become very distressed. Sometimes we forget to live in such a way that we recognize Him. And you know what? Worship is recognizing Him all the time. We're recognizing and living in such a way that we're recognizing His lordship over us in every situation. Not just when we're at church. But on all occasions, if we're going to worship Him, learn to recognize His presence, not just in not just the content, not just to be able to say, yeah, I know God's always with me. But make it a discipline, make it a practice, a conscious, aware, a conscious awareness. There are times I think people call me because I'm crazy, but I often consider that Jesus Christ is sitting in the seat beside me while I'm driving. Oh, it's awkward. Did you just see that guy cut me off? Why not? Why not? You know what the benefit of that is? If I acknowledge and recognize that Jesus is there with me, I can talk to Him and flush that out of your system instead of that road rage thing. Amen? My wife, Cindy, when I started to act out, I think I told you this, when I started to walk to act out, perhaps in pharmacist or whatever, she walked up to me and whispered in my ear, Jesus is watching you. Recognizing the presence of God. He has said, we love the Father, shall never leave us or forsake us. Worship is recognizing His presence. Wherever you are, wherever you go, in certain circles of Jewish life, they always said a feast. There's an empty chair. And in that tradition, it's paid and reserved for the Messiah. Acknowledge and recognize that He is with you. Now, I can assure you, He's a life leader. You know what I mean? You can feel His presence, but you know, at the same time, His presence calls us to an attitude of awe and admiration and adoration of the living God. That adoration is the Creator of the universe. Consider this for a moment. The Creator of the universe wants to dry down love of me. That He wants to stay with me, He wants to be with me, He wants to abide with me, and He's the same with you. The Creator of the universe desires that relationship with you. Wow, that should cause us to adore Him, to worship Him. He desires this in your life. God Almighty knows you by name. He counts the hair on your head.
And I do realize that, you know, sometimes His job is less than
for others.
When I was doing junior high work, I used to say to the junior high, we talk about God counting the hair. You want to give God something to do? And I get a little clock out of it. I can't do that anymore. I don't have any respect.
The intent of acknowledging His presence is to form an intimacy, a relationship towards with fellowship, with time invested together with Him. But that's only the first aspect. The second thing, the call to worship, involves recognizing the person of God. The old song is very true. The longer I serve Him, the sweeter He grows. It's very true. If we look back at the first six verses of Psalm 95, verse 1 speaks that He is the rock of our salvation. There is nothing, there is no one else worthy of our trust or faith, because He is the one that is the source of our salvation. Praise God. The person of Jesus Christ. Let us respond by worshiping God, for He has saved us, rescued us from hell. And sometimes, in verse 2, He's the great God, He's above all things. There is no God like Jehovah. No one compares to Him. In all things God is able. In all things God is faithful. No. Acknowledge that and count yourself on that. And as we do, we will begin to worship His person. Because God is great and greatly to be praised. In verse 4, God is greater than the height, and He's greater than the depth. God is omnipresent, so He's in all places all at the same time. So when I have family members thousands of miles away, and I can't get to them, I don't have to be distressed. I don't have to worry. Take it to the Lord in prayer, because He's over there. He is there. How great is our God! He is worthy of all of our worship. As we acknowledge His person, recognize His person, calls us to answer the call to worship Him. In verse 5, He owns. You do know He owns all of creation. He owns the land. He owns the sea. He owns the air. He owns the heavens, because He is the Creator of all things. He is Almighty God. Come, let us worship and bow down. And worship Him.
perhaps you heard the joke that he bought it. He said, you know, I brought you into the trail about to take you out.
Greater still, God put you and created you, and God can take you out. Worship him.
He said, you know, in modern days, we don't preach here. Well, that's what it takes to get you rid of God to worship him. All right?
The key is to recognize how great and glorious.
Verse 6.
Let's worship God because he is our maker.
Right? You see the movies that are, I believe that sometimes doctors say, you know, there's not much hope for you. You better go and get ready to meet your maker. Go and prepare to meet God. If you were to go to the eternity today, are you prepared? Are you happy with how you responded? Have you worshiped him out? Now we're saved by grace. We're saved through believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. But beyond this, the call to worship is a call to recognize and receive the presence of God. Because this is the presence of God. No, by this we can be the presence of God. Not T-R-E, as it says, S-E-N-T-E, but the T-R-E, I couldn't say blessings of God.
The blessing of salvation, worthy of it all because of our salvation, redeeming you from the pit. What a blessing. Rescuing us from sin.
What a blessing.
Resurrecting us from death and life. Seating us in heavenly places. Let's worship him.
The blessing giving us his Holy Spirit provides with us.
Comfort us, teach us, convict us. Praise God, he's worthy of all of our worship.
We have many blessings of providing for us in ways we can't imagine.
Healing us body, mind, and soul. Encouraging us with brothers and sisters in Christ. What a great God we serve. And yet we often say, I don't have time.
Inviting us to cast all of our cares on him, for we know that he cares for us.
Now the word worship in its simplest form means worship. It means recognizing the one who is the supreme work. God has revealed himself and his purposes through Jesus Christ. And he is worthy of all praise and glory and honor. He is worthy. He should be the most prized relationship, the most prized priority in our lives. That's what worship is. Sometimes we reduce worship to coming and singing a song in this room. Worship is considering and living in such a way that he is the most prized thing in your life. That nothing compares to him. That nothing will violate your relationship with him. And it's a violation we choose God. Choose you this day whom you will serve. He is worthy.
I encourage you this morning to worship the Lord your God and Maker. Honor him with all that you are.
This consistency in prayer.
Do I have a choice? Am I going to watch 20 minutes of The Price is Right?
Or I can spend that 20 minutes in prayer. But I like the brazen trumpet. Or the... It's true. What's more important, God or a football game? God, what is there that is more important than He is? Nothing. So worshiping Him is in all that you do, honoring Him, and if you have that choice, then you make choices 100 times a day, if not more. Choose Him. He's the most important thing in your life. The most important relationship in your life. It means recognizing the one who is of supreme worth. God has revealed Himself to us, and I encourage you this morning to worship the Lord your God and make her honoring Him in all that you are, in all that you do. Now, as the week comes, we're going to talk about prayer. Recognize that you have the honor, the blessing of praying to God Almighty. Can you imagine that? That the one who created all that is wants to talk to you. He wants to talk to you. He invites you to pray. Greater still, He not only hears this when we pray, but the Creator of all that is likes it. You know those people in your life, so when they start talking, you turn up. But God doesn't do that. God likes it when you pray. He hears it when we pray. And what blows me away, no matter how many millions of people are praying, He listens to each one carefully because He's the great and glorious God. God shows how great God is. You will never get a busy cone. You'll never be put on hold. To call the suicide helpline and put on hold. As we discuss Bible study, know that there should be nothing more precious in our routine than that time we spend reading and studying His Word. Whatever it takes, develop the discipline of reading God's Word. As He was saying on the video, it's not a one-time talk. It's every day focusing on Him, reading His Word. It's every day worshiping Him, acknowledging Him, recognizing Him. If you apply this, it would be good. It would be much good. Lord Jesus, I just thank you. I thank you that you're God. And there is nothing else I can do. And even though you made all things, Lord, your grace is extended toward us, and you have loved us, and you desire for us to be your children, and we are humbled by you. Lord, I just pray that you will answer the call to worship. That we would have and acknowledge you as our King and our God. Thank you for your patience and your grace in our lives today. Would you stand with me for a moment?